Hello and welcome to the Behind the Stripes football webcast, the first edition of the 2010 season. Dave, it was an eventful offseason. It appeared for a while Missouri might end up in the Big Ten, then appeared they might end up homeless, and then they wind up in the Big 12 with 10 teams. Let's just take a look at maybe how you think the conference that they're in now and what it will become will affect their football fortunes.
Well, I think it's going to be a lot harder to win a championship in the Big 12 with only 10 teams, because with the model that's been proposed and all but made official, is there's going to be no championship game. So there is no North and South division. There's no division championship that you can claim. It'll just come down to the team with the best conference record at the end of the year, which I think most people agree is the fairest way to determine a championship, because your whole body of work from the season counts and everybody plays everybody. So in that light, Missouri's schedule, I think, gets tougher because they have to play all those teams from the South Division. You don't have a situation where you only play in Oklahoma or Texas. You're going to play both every year. So I think it's going to force everybody to get better or to do something else with your program. I mean, you're going to have to really compete against those teams to have what most will consider a good season and a good program. So you better be able to compete.
I guess maybe one thing it will make harder is that I always felt like when they were in the North, they kind of had a puncher's chance always. That's obviously the weaker of the two divisions. So if you can just make the Big 12 championship game, maybe you've got a shot at winning the Big 12 title and going to a BCS game. That will not be the case anymore. I think it's going to be pretty rough for them to get through Oklahoma and Texas and whoever else is good.
Yeah.
So it's a little tougher in that way. In terms of recruiting, do you think there's much difference now? You eliminate Nebraska and Colorado. I don't think Colorado recruited Texas a ton, but Nebraska did a little. How do you think that will be affected?
Well, I think it helps your exposure in the state of Texas, because you're going to be on TV more, period, and you're going to play more games physically in the state of Texas because of playing more games against the South. And that's probably a positive if you're Missouri and if you were worried about your exposure in Texas. I know Iowa State coach Paul Rhodes was asked the same question last week at Big 12 Media Day, and he said it had an immediate impact because they got two commitments from the state of Texas, two kids who said the fact that Iowa State's going to be on TV more often in the state of Texas and playing more in the state of Texas led them to want to play there and commit to them early. So if you're those North teams who are worried about, you know, how the state of Texas was going to be impacted and your influence there, I guess this has to be considered positive.
And just lastly, scheduling. Obviously, in-conference scheduling, you're going to play basically a round robin, but non-conference, I think there could be a pretty big divergence of opinion on how to do that. In the past, Missouri has usually played one BCS conference opponent, one Division I AA or football championship subdivision opponent, and then two kind of mid-majorish type teams. How do you think now that there's a three-game non-conference schedule that's going to change?
Well, Mack Brown, Texas coach, last week said he hopes that everyone plays one big marquee game still, like some teams have, and Texas isn't one that always plays one big marquee game. Mm-hmm. They've played Ohio State in the past, and I believe they play them in the future, and that's what he used as an example that he hopes everyone does. But I think not many people will probably agree with him in the Big 12. I think if you're Gary Pinkel, you look at your schedules and say, okay, we're not only going to play Oklahoma every year, but we're going to add Texas, and you want me to play someone even tougher in September? Probably not. I think they'll, if anything, maybe scale down a little bit. You know, on the books, they still have Indiana and Arizona State as a BCS opponent for future years. I'm guessing they'll keep those and then fill in the blanks elsewhere. And I'm guessing most teams around the Big 12 will do something similar. Iowa State believes that their schedule with Iowa will stay, that rivalry, and that will be their BCS opponent. I don't think they'll go after anybody else bigger than that. And, you know, everyone has their own decision to make on how they want to do this, but I just can't imagine too many teams are hungry to play some big, great opponent when things are going to get tougher in October and November.
Mm-hmm. Missouri kind of had a nice setup when they were playing Illinois every year, too, which is going to go away after this year, so that's
right.
Unfortunate. I think you're probably right. I think September has just kind of become a wasteland. It kind of is already, but I think it's just going to be patsies. That would be my guess. He hasn't come out and said that, as far as I know.
Yeah, and they don't want to say anything until this Big 12 format is official. They just don't want to, you know, put anything out there publicly before the Big 12 has decided officially what it wants to do. So eventually that'll happen.
Now, from Dan Beebe's point of view, the commissioner is you don't have the Big 12 championship game now to improve your strength of schedule. So if you're wanting to play for a national championship, you better schedule harder. But I think a lot of coaches, other than maybe Texas and Oklahoma, they aren't really thinking that way. They're thinking, how do I win 8 games or so and save my job? They're right. not thinking along the lines of that.
Saving their job and having that bonus kick in for winning your 8th or 9th game. Yeah, I don't think they're too worried about strength of schedule, which strength of schedule is kind of misnomer these days because it's not a huge factor in the BCS. It's a part of all the computer rankings, but it's not – people don't think – who really study these numbers, that the human voters really pay much attention to strength of schedule. By the time it's November, December, and you're voting for who plays in the championship games, voters don't look at September very often.
Yeah. If they had gone to the Big Ten, how do you think that would have affected their football program, Missouri's?
I think the Big Ten, as in general, there's more parity from top to bottom. But I think the Big 12, the elite teams, Texas and Oklahoma are more consistently elite, so I think it would maybe be easier to win a championship in the Big Ten. It'd probably be easier to finish 2nd or 3rd if you're Missouri, and I think it'll be easier for Nebraska now to finish 2nd or 3rd, perhaps win the Big Ten once they get there. But I do think there are some other positives that would have worked out for Missouri. I think geographically, I think they're as good a fit in the Big Ten if they would have been in the Big 12. Recruiting is the thing we mentioned with Texas. You don't know how that would have worked out. But the trade-off would have been more revenue and, more exposure. Because if you're in the Big Ten, you're not making announcements like Missouri did this week that they're playing have to play 2 games on pay-per-view. Mm-hmm. There's the Big Ten Network that would all but assure that your games are going to be on TV regardless of having to use this pay-per-view option. So I think as a whole it would have been a positive for the football program. There would have been some uncertainties with recruiting. You would have given up some of your longtime rivals with Kansas and some of the others, but I think it still would have been a positive thing for Missouri.
All right, let's look ahead to preseason practice that starts on Thursday. One issue, I guess, that wasn't totally resolved in the spring, although we got a little bit of a hint, is what Missouri's going to do with their quarterbacks this year. Obviously, Blaine Gabbert is the starter, but then behind him, you have last year's number two was Jimmy Costello. You have two true freshmen in James Franklin and Tyler Gabbert, and then you also have Ashton Glazer. And so by the end of spring, Franklin seemed like the guy, and if that continues, does he play as a true freshman, or how do you think they're going to work it?
Well, he opens camp this week as the number two, and I think it's fair to say he didn't really blow anybody away this spring. It seemed pretty deliberate that they made him number two. And they'll never admit this, but you've got to think in the back of their mind, they're concerned about Blaine Gabbert possibly leaving early for the NFL, so they would like to have a quarterback ready, get some game experience for the heir there, and that would presumably be James Franklin, because I think he's the best long-term option. So I wouldn't be surprised if you see him get some playing time this year, even if that means if Gabbert sticks around that you've got another year for Franklin to be the number two. So kind of a delicate situation. I don't think Gary Pinkel will address it head-on at all this next 3 weeks or so. I mean, they're not going to say the kid's going to play for sure. So it'll be interesting to see how many snaps he gets, what kind of work he gets. If he gets a lot of work with the starting offensive line and receivers in camp, that tells you that they've got an idea that he'll play this year. And if anything, it gives them a better insurance policy should something happen to Gabbert like it did last year when they didn't feel like they had a better option than a hobbled Blaine Gabbert once he got hurt. If they can get Franklin ready and prepared, maybe they go in with a better idea of having a backup ready.
Yeah, I think Missouri kind of goes a different way than a lot of teams do that kind of consider when you get a player you like, you consider every year precious. I don't know that they really think that way. Mm-hmm. I think they've kind of established, especially with quarterbacks, that they would just as soon play them even if you don't really need to play them. And just figure, well, by the time this guy's a senior, we'll have found someone else who's also good. And it's worked. I mean, you can't really argue with the results.
Right.
What they did with Chase Daniel and then again with Blaine Gabbert. I mean, I think that is their philosophy, and I would be surprised if they didn't continue it this year.
Right.
Defensively, I think as you look, Gary Pinkel, he's now entering his 10th year here. Pretty consistently, you've seen them put out offenses that are capable of competing with most teams. Defensively, there's been a couple of okay years, but just generally speaking, defense has never been quite the equal to the offense. And it's maybe what separated them from having great seasons. Why do you think that is?
I think one factor is if you look at the two best statistical defenses under Pinkel, it was 2004, which wasn't a very good year, but the defense was good, and 2007. And if you look at those two defenses, they both had two really good Big 12 defensive tackles in the middle, C.J. Mosley and Tia Ellison in 04, 07 with Ziggy Hood and Lorenzo Williams. Mm-hmm. And I just think you can't – I don't think that's a coincidence. I think those are four good players. Three of them are still playing in the NFL. Lorenzo Williams is not, but he was a first-team All-Big 12 player his senior year. And you've got to start there, and I think that just sets the tone for your entire defense, for all the guys behind you, when you have two really solid guys that can play the run and the pass well. And it just sets you up for good things, and it has in those couple years where Missouri's had two good ones. And I think some other factors on defense, it seems like historically Missouri's taken maybe a few more chances with junior college transfers, most of them that have come through Missouri. And some of them had nice careers, like Pig Brown. Castine Bridges turned out to be a decent corner by his senior year. It just seems like they take a few more risks on guys to play on that side of the ball. Some have worked out, probably a lot more haven't. So it's part of it's recruiting, part of it's player development, but I think it goes back to having a really good defensive line. And this year they've got the great pass rusher in Alden Smith off the edge, but you look in the middle there, are they going to be good enough to play with the best teams on their schedule with their defensive line? I'm not sure yet. We know the answer.
Yeah, I think also sometimes if you're a school like Missouri, when you're trying to reach maybe a little bit and get a kid who would be considering another school like an Oklahoma or Texas A&M or whatever, and he's a kid that's a multi-position athlete, a lot of times those kids want to play offense, and maybe at a school it's maybe a notch above Missouri in the pecking order, they would want him for defense, and Missouri can get him by making him an offensive player. Maybe that's part of it. And Pinkel obviously has a background in offense, so maybe it's just natural that he kind of his influence, or he gravitates a little more to those kids. But I don't know. I hadn't really thought too much of it in terms of those defensive tackles, like you mentioned, but that is kind of true, and that maybe is not a great sign for this year, because every year there's a little tweak they're talking about, and in the spring it all looks fantastic in the preseason, but then once the season starts, do you have much hope that it's going to be much different this year?
Yeah, and those are look at the two best teams in this league every year, Oklahoma and Texas. We mentioned it a lot, but they always have NFL players up front, and it all starts there. This year, Dominique Hamilton is a guy who kind of established himself last year. Next to him is Terrell Rosano, and I think it's safe to say he hasn't yet. So if they can develop a couple guys in there, bring somebody in off the bench, then I think they'll have a chance to be better. But this next month will really help determine some of that.
Well, speaking of defensive tackles, we'll go to a few quick questions here to finish it off. One who Missouri has been anticipating for a few years now, Sheldon Richardson, I think on his Facebook page maybe pointed out he was going to be playing junior college football this year when it had been originally planned he was going to redshirt. How does that affect things if that comes to pass?
Well, I haven't had any direct correspondence with Sheldon yet, but nothing is ever set in stone with Richardson. It seems like the plan originally was for him to redshirt last year, play this year, then transfer to Missouri. He decided to play last year, redshirt this year, transfer to Missouri. Now it's play last year, play this year, come and transfer to Missouri. It seems like Sheldon, if we can decipher his Facebook message, he just wants to get to the NFL as soon as possible. If that really is his intent, if he's good enough to do that, I think Missouri will just be satisfied with getting him here, whether it's for 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, whatever happens with him. They'll hope for the best, and you really can't tell the kid he has to sit out. They'll take what they can get with him at this point, because if he's good enough to go to the NFL, then he'll have that opportunity if he only plays here for a year or two.
And this is kind of an extension of what we're talking about with the quarterbacks. I think they've gotten this philosophy now where if you get four good years out of a kid, who cares? Or maybe if you get three good years out of a kid, whether he redshirts or not, that's probably what's going to be. So
right.
In his case, if you can get two good years out of him, I guess they'll be happy. As far as the recruits qualifying, what have you heard about that, and do you think they'll all make it?
They're all expected to be here. All are enrolled, and it's been a while since that's happened at Missouri, but everyone that they signed is on campus and expected to be there.
All right, just lastly, what kind of record would you say would qualify this as a successful season?
Well, I think if you look at the schedule, the non-conference schedule is really soft this year. I think 9-3 should be sort of the baseline standard. And that means they beat everybody that they should, and that during that four-game October stretch, which is pretty difficult, three road games against good teams and a home game against Oklahoma, you got to pull off, I guess you can consider an upset in one of those. They go to Texas A&M, go to Nebraska, go to Texas Tech, and then, of course, Oklahoma comes here. So you've got to win one of those and beat everybody else. That's 9-3. I don't think you can be disappointed with that at all. And I think at Missouri, they're at the point now with how they're recruiting and how they're scheduling that should be the standard.
And I was thinking more, I thought maybe 8-4 would be an acceptable year, just because when you look at that stretch in the middle, it seems like it wouldn't be too hard to think they could win their first four, lose their next four, then win their last four. But last year what we saw was a team that was capable of doing some things you weren't quite expecting, like taking care of business on the road, but then at home they would foul up. And so it was not a super predictable team. I think maybe that's part of that's being young.
Yeah.
Now you've got a more experienced team. But I think, 9-3 I think would be considered a great year for Missouri with this crew. Not because, I guess, I kind of weigh it as you've got a lot of more experience, but you don't really have the star power they had last year, which is, and it's not like Denario Alexander was just kind of a big part of their offense. He was their offense. I mean, by the end of the year,
Right. Basically
every play was designed to get him the ball, and so
Right. It's
not like, I don't know, I just think it's going to be, that is going to be a tough thing to replace, and they don't really, from what we saw in the spring, don't have a ton of receivers that are just chomping at the bit to fill his shoes.
That's a great point. Then again, a year ago this time, I don't think anyone expected Denaro to have that kind of year
healthy.
That he did, and to even be healthy. So maybe somebody emerges and a couple guys combine to have a year as good as he had, and their offense will still be in good shape. So we'll find out.
All right, well, we'll start finding out on Thursday. We'll be back next week to discuss the first week of practice.